It's Professor Dave. Let's talk about Fischer projections.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So we've talked about stereochemistry, chirality. We've talked about how to assign R and S by the chan-ingold-prelog convention. We've covered that in previous tutorials. However, I like to do that using regular line notation. And while it's not my favorite, it's not the way that I like to do it, I know that other introductory organic chemistry courses often do this using Fischer projections. And so I wanted to talk a bit about that just for students who are learning stereochemistry that way in their courses. I have talked about Fischer projections in my biochemistry tutorials because this notation is typically used with linear sugars, linear carbohydrates, or simple sugars like monosaccharides. And so that is typically the application of this notation. But for whatever reason, some courses like to use this to introduce stereochemistry. So I wanted to talk about this a little bit to make sure everybody understands what this notation means. So when we see Fischer projections, we're not going to any longer see those wedges and dash bonds. We're going to see things flat like this. And so we're still understanding that every vertex and endpoint is a carbon atom. So for example, this is implied to be a carbon atom, but there's something about the stereochemistry of these bonds that is also implied. And what is implied by this notation is that any horizontal bonds are implied to be wedge bonds, and any vertical bonds are implied to be dash bonds. So the geometry of this, right, this implies this, okay? And so you can, if you forget, you can remember that by, you can see a little bow tie. There's a little bow tie on every carbon, essentially, is one way to remember that. And so this means this. And this also looks a little strange. We're used to including at least one of the bonds in the plane of the board. So having all four of these bonds either projecting outwards or inwards is strange. We can envision it this way, though. Imagine this is the molecule we're talking about. And imagine you're in plane right here looking at it this way. You would see D and B coming towards you like this. That's those. And you would see A and C going away like this. So this is another way of drawing this molecule, but written that way. Okay, so that's just the necessary information. We do need to know horizontal implies wedge, vertical implies dash. We're typically going to see this with longer molecules like this. So imagine something like this. We've got methyls here, and then we've got a hydroxyl on one side or the other on each of these three carbons. So we've got carbon, 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 and again, we have to remember that this is not implying that this is a flat molecule. These are sp3 hybridized carbons. Those are tetrahedral centers. And so another way of thinking of this is when we have a longer one like this, what can get confusing is because these are all implied to be dash bonds. It might seem strange. How can we have all these dash bonds in a row? That might seem illogical. So one way you can think of it is sort of a horseshoe-shaped thing where you're almost going through a Rolodex. You can imagine yourself riding this like a roller coaster and pulling each carbon up to you. But notice that each successive bond is going further and further away from you. So this is this, right? If we're looking at this, we know that we've got, if we're looking down upon this molecule, we are seeing this. We've got OH to the right, which would be the wedge. We've got OH to the left, which would be the dash. OH to the right, which would be the wedge. So we want to be able to visualize the actual molecule. We want to be able to understand that this is not showing the accurate geometry of the molecule and see it this way. But sometimes we will be using this notation for various purposes, whether we're looking at sugars or non-sugars, just regular molecules. And so now that we understand what Fischer projection notation implies, now we can start to assign R and S on molecules in that notation. Okay, so we're going to want to be able to assign R and S on molecules written in Fischer notation. And so to do this, we need the chan-ingold-prelog convention. If you haven't seen my tutorial on that convention yet, watch that one first. That explains the convention. But if we're up to speed with that, then we can look at a molecule here, and what we're going to do, it's not that different from what we already know and the tricks that we talked about there. So first, we just have to remember, assign priority based on atomic number, right? So we know that the highest atomic number, that's bromine, so that'll be 1. 2 is chlorine, so that'll be 2. F is next, That'll be third, and then hydrogen is fourth. So the key thing here we remember is that we need to have the lowest priority group facing away from us, right? That's what we have to do. So hydrogen has to be away from us, and the thing with Fischer projections is if the lowest priority substituent is on a vertical bond, that is implied to be a dash bond, so it is away from you. So in this case, right, this hydrogen is on that vertical bond, so it is away from us. In such a case, we can just trace from 1 to 2 to 3 exactly as is shown, and we can get R and S from there. So here, if we go from 1 to 2 to 3, we're going to go like this. That's clockwise, so this is R, okay? Because the lowest priority group was already away from us. Now, that will be the case, once again, when the lowest priority substituent is on a vertical bond, because the vertical bond is implied to be the dash bond. Now, here's the case where the lowest priority group is on a horizontal bond. If the lowest priority group is on a horizontal bond, that is implied to be a wedge bond, and that is not facing away from us. So in such a case, we just do our regular trick that we talked about in the other tutorial. We can pretend as though two groups have been swapped, although we don't even have to swap them. Once again, we're just going to assign, this is priority one, this is priority two, this is priority three. Now, let's just trace from 1 to 2 to 3 exactly as shown. We're going to go like that. So it looks like S. However, this was not the appropriate way to do it because the H was facing towards us. Recall that anytime you swap two groups on a stereocenter, you're inverting the stereochemistry. So if we had swapped, say, hydrogen and fluorine, then we would have had H on the dash bond. However, in doing so, we would invert the stereochemistry. So the way that we can account for that is we can simply pretend that hydrogen is away from us, assess it as is, and then invert our answer. So it looks like S, therefore is R. So this one is also R. So once again, when the lowest priority group is on a vertical bond, on a Fischer projection, you can assess R and S as is, just trace from 1 to 2 to 3, and clockwise is R, counterclockwise is S. However, when the lowest priority substituent is on a horizontal bond, that is a case where we trace from 1 to 2 to 3, and then the easiest way to do it is just do that and then invert your answer to the other option. That will account for the fact that the lowest priority group was actually towards us rather than away from us. So that's the easiest way to assign R and S to stereocenters when molecules are drawn in Fischer projection form. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.